Yo, what's up, everybody? It's your boy Steve from Off the Clock Tips and Tricks. And, well, so far we've talked about how to manage people, how to delegate to your people, right? Why all that, you know, is necessary and how it all helps you, it makes your life easier. Okay, well, I know that some of you guys are probably thinking, well, yeah, that sounds all good and dandy, you know, but my guys do whatever the fuck they want. They don't listen to me, right? Okay, I know that's a big problem, you know? How do you gain control over a crew that you have no control over? It sucks, and it's a feeling of impotence, you know, when your guys don't listen to you, and it's frustrating, and it makes your life suck. I've been there. So how do you fix it? I can't necessarily tell you how to fix it. All I can do is share with you how I fixed it, what I did. Is it the best approach? I don't know, but it worked. So, just a little background story on how I came to be as far as a store manager. I was an assistant manager. My store manager was the shit. Everybody loved him. Everybody respected him. He was tough, but he was fair. Okay, well, he got sick and he took a few days off, which turned into a few weeks, which turned into a few months, which turned into a total of 9 months with no manager. And I was his right hand guy, so he left me in charge. And he told me, Steve, if you need my help, you know, I'm just down the street, give me a call. I didn't want to bother him, right? So I did my best. And like I've mentioned in other videos, I never really managed anything, right? Like, I was his assistant, but all I did was just take care of customers, just so that he didn't have to, so that he could do, you know, all the managerial stuff. Well, now I have to do it all. So before I became store manager, I was just one of the guys, right? I was one of everybody else, you know. So I came up from within. Because I didn't really take my managerial role, my assistant managerial role, serious, and I was just one of the guys, I was cool with everybody. I was really cool with everybody, to the point where we would kick it on the weekends and get shit-faced drunk. Because of that, my guys never saw me as any sort of authority, right? I was just Steve. I was just, you know, Steve. There was nothing special. And all of a sudden, I'm the guy that's telling them, hey man, I need you to do this. Hey, please do this. Hey, can you do this? Hey, can you finish that? They didn't want to listen to me. I get all kinds of talk back, right? At first, you know, it was just kind of like, ah, fuck you, you know? And it was kind of like, ha ha ha, all right, no, for reals, dude, like, I need it done. But after a while, it was more like, you know, they're irritated at me and I'm irritated at them, you know? And they're like, you know, ask so-and-so to do it. I'm asking you to do it, man. I don't want to do it. I'm doing this. Dude, that's not gonna take you long. When you're done with that, do this. Nah, tell so-and-so, like that, right? I'm sure you guys have experienced this on your own level. It's frustrating, right? Especially when they're like your friends. They're your friends, so you don't wanna be like a complete asshole to them, you know, but you feel like maybe that's the only way, right? One way or another, it's not gonna end good, right? Well, my friends at work, what they would do is, they would bitch and moan and complain, but they would do the work, but it would cost me so much effort and energy. It was like pulling teeth with these guys, you know, like, you know, come on, dude, like, I need you to do it, man. Like, I'm fucking busy as fuck. So like I was saying, guys, my crew didn't take me serious, you know. I was just Party Steve and, you know, trying to tell him what to do, thinking he's the boss now, thinking he's all cool because he's in charge, right? That's how my guys saw it. I know it because they fucking told me straight up. And, you know, like I said, after months, you know, like, I'm sick and tired of these guys not listening, not doing any work. I'm sick and tired of me being the only one that's pulling weight, you know, so I started getting a little tougher with the guys. Again, I didn't have the ability to even fucking write them up. I couldn't fire them. I couldn't do shit. These guys were coming to work whenever the fuck they felt like. They would call in, or they would just come in late. They would take hour and a half lunches. You know, it was a fucking mess. You know, plus, none of them were doing, like, their normal basic job, right? So I started getting tough with them, you know, just vocally, and they would talk back. They would tell me straight up, you know, you're not my boss. Gary's my boss. If Gary tells me to do this, I'll do it. Like that, right? It was bad. It got to a point that was really bad. Well, once I got the title, it was on, right? I had it out for them. I'm like, I'm gonna fucking write these motherfuckers left and right. I'm gonna fucking fire them, you know? And I tried. And I would call corporate and they would say, no. You don't have any prior documentation. We can't fire them. You know, this termination is not approved. So after so many times of trying to fire people and trying to write them up and getting denied, I figured out how to do it the right way, and I got really good at it. Well, I started putting the pressure on these guys, on putting them on paper, right? Documenting them. Some of them left on their own. Some of them I actually fired, right? The ones left on their own was because they knew what was coming and they didn't want to deal with it and they didn't care, so they just bounced. The guys who stuck around, they either got with it or they got out one way or the other, right? But still, I had a good amount of people who didn't take me serious and didn't, you know, do what I asked them to do. But we're very short-handed, so I can't just fire everybody, you know? I can't fire like half of the fucking store because I'm barely surviving with the few people that I got. So I started hiring people, and I started hiring pretty much anybody with a fucking pulse, right? Just to get people in the store to like help with basic functions. Someone to at least clean and, you know, sweep and mop and throw out the trash and, you know, restock my shelves while the rest of us, you know, help customers, something, right? I would hire people, and because we were so short-handed, I didn't train them. I just threw them out to the wolves and I watched them get torn apart, right? And some of them quit because they couldn't handle the stress, and I don't blame them. You know, I didn't teach them how to do anything, and then just said, hey, you know, do your best, and if you have questions, ask us, we'll help you, while we're trying to scramble and make, you know, everything happen in the store. It was a high stress environment. It was chaotic to say the least. Well, I would hire people and hire people, right? And some of them would quit, the ones that would stay but sucked because I didn't teach them how to do anything, I fired them before their 90 days probation period was up, you know? So it was just a revolving door with people, you know? And I remembered I hired this one gal, this young girl. She liked cars and she applied, you know? And it's not that common that, you know, a girl apply like in a automotive, you know, business. So I'm like, you know, I like to have a mix of, you know, guys and gals on my crew, you know, so that all my clientele can feel comfortable with somebody, right? They can identify with somebody, you know? So when I interviewed this gal, I went through the interview questions and I asked her, you know, what are you looking for in your future employer? And she said, I want to be properly trained on how to do my job. I said, okay. I thought to myself in my head, I don't really have time to properly train, right? Again, I'm a new manager at this point and I was doing things all bad, you know? So yes, that was a bad thought to have. But I asked her another question. I said, what are you looking for? What are you least looking forward to in your next employer? And she said, I don't want to be held accountable for something that I was never taught how to do. And I thought to myself, ooh, I do that a lot. I do that a lot with all these new guys. I've been doing that. I said, okay. Long story short, I hired her. And her last week on her 90-day probation, I fired her. Because she didn't know how to do anything. And I felt guilty as fuck. I felt guilty as fuck because I knew that I was firing her for something that she, like, specifically said that she didn't want to happen. It happened. This store was so chaotic and so busy and still running on such a short-handed crew that this girl specifically a couple of times vanished from the sales floor. We would be all helping customers, they'd be going crazy, phones off the hook, tons of lines of customers, and she would disappear. And one time I found her in the back room crying, with her hands on her head, you know, like elbows on the table, just crying. She had a panic attack, you know, and it happened a couple other times when I wasn't in the store, and I was like, I mean, I don't blame the girl, you know, like I'm not bashing on her. I don't blame her. It was a high stress environment and she didn't know how to do shit. So yeah, customers would give her attitude, you know, she'd ask for help. Everyone's busy. Her customers, meanwhile, getting irritated. It was impotence. It's a horrible feeling, you know? So I let her go because, well, one, I can't have her just freak out on me, right? And, you know, she was too far gone for me to try to help at that point. And I didn't want to get stuck with her. There was other things about this gal, you know, that just told me, you know, like, it's too much work to get this one up to speed. I need someone who has a little bit more potential that I can polish. Well, I let her go, and I felt really guilty, like I said. But after that, I said, you know what? I can't do this no more. You know, it's not fair to them. It's not fair to the rest of my crew. You know, I'm hiring all these people, and they don't help because they don't know how to do anything. It cost all of us a whole bunch of extra effort and work to help them out. You know, it slows us down even more. Like it's counterintuitive, you know, for me to hire these people and not train them. So I said, the next person that I hire, I'm going to train them, and I'm going to teach them exactly what they need to know so that they're actually good at their job, so that they can actually help us, so that they actually contribute to pulling the rope in the same direction. I need to make them a helper, not just another warm body to put someone on hold, you know? So what I did, back to, you know, my point, what I did with my very next hire is I scheduled this person to come in around the middle of my day when I had the bulk of my crew at work. I have my morning shift, my mid shift, and my evening shift all overlapping. So I brought this person to come in like around 10 o'clock. All right. So at 10 o'clock, I told everybody, I'm invisible for the next 4 hours. So-and-so's in charge. If you guys need anything, so-and-so's in charge. Don't come back to the back room and bother me. I'm going to be training the new guy. So mind you, we're still really short-handed and we're still really, really busy. So I'm sitting in the back room and I'm teaching this person basic cashiering operations, how to ring up, how to refund, right? And I'm having them do it over and over and over in the back room where no one's around, no one's, you know, distracting us. And meanwhile, I'm getting my guys, you know, popping their head around the corner every like so often. They're like, hey, Steve, can you help us out? We're slammed. And I'm like, I can't, man. Go ask so-and-so. Like, we're slammed. I'm like, I understand, man. Right now, I'm busy. And my guys were getting pissed at me because in their eyes, they're like, Steve's just in the back room. We're drowning up here and Steve's in the back room. Yes, it's true. Yes, it's true. I was letting them, you know, fend for themselves. But what I was doing is I was investing my time to train this person so that when this person comes to the front room, they can actually help. So I spent 4 hours with this person on day one, training them on how to ring up, how to refund, how to do a warranty return, how to do a warranty exchange, how to do a core return, how to do a cash into check, check into cash, cash into charge, charge into check, you know, all these different types of transactions. And I had them do it a million times over and over and over and over it, to the point where seriously, like, they had it on autopilot, where they were annoyed and irritated themselves. Like I know how to do it. Like, show me again. I had them prove it to me over and over and over that they knew how to do each little operation. And once they got that one down, we moved on to a next one and to a next one and to a next one. The next day, it was a training similar of something else. How to look up parts, you know, what everything on the screen meant, you know. And the next day was how to order parts. The next day was how to do something else and something else and something else and something else. I spent a week, 4 hours a day for a week with each new employee, right? Not helping a single customer. Me not being in the front for 4 hours a day. Mind you, during this time, I'm opening and closing the store. I'm working at from 6:30 in the morning to 10 o'clock, 11 o'clock at night. You know, so it was just 4 hours a day that I'm missing from the store. I was still working like fucking 16 hours or so. Anyways, so we're training and training and training and training, right? And after training was over, then it was a little bit more hands-on training. Week two, this person's only working 4 hours, right? We're still super slammed. We're still shorthanded. Week two, all right. Today, you're gonna scan in all my daily inventory. Everything that came in from our distribution center, you're gonna scan it. And you're gonna separate it into totes, and you're gonna semi-organize it in those totes by aisle. And this is how you do it. And I would show them. And I would show them, and I would show them myself, you know, and I would do the act for a good 5 minutes while they're just watching me. And then I say, okay, now you do it. And then they would do it. And as they're doing it, I would critique and I would, you know, correct and I would, you know, adjust their approach so that it matches mine. I wanted them to be like me. At this point, what I'm doing is I'm trying to clone myself into everyone that I hire. So I got them to scan an inventory the way that I would, right? Now that they're scanning inventory, now I can go back up to the front. I can go back up to the front and check on my crew, see how they're doing, help out in the front, do my thing. And then when I have a moment to breathe, I go to the back room, check on my new hire, see how they're doing. They're doing good or they're not doing good. I correct them if they're not doing good. Correct, you know, give them props for doing good. Once they're done with that, all right, I'm not gonna help any customers. What I want you to do now is I want you to do this. I want you to, you know, put away the inventory. And I would show them, this is how you check where it goes. You know, and this is what it means. And this is what this means. And this is how you find out this. And this is what, you know, you gotta teach them the who, what, when, where, why of each little thing so that they understand it completely. You know, hey, two of them go on the shelf right here and this is why. And this is how you know. And this is what it means. And this is this and this is that. So that it's over information, but it gives them a broader understanding of why things are. And why I ask for certain things. It's not just because Steve says and that's it. No, it's because this is why and this is how, all that, right? So I had them doing all these other behind the scenes type of things, right? Meanwhile, my guys are still pissed off at me, right? Because I have like confidants and they're like, yo, Steve, man, like, you know, can we use so-and-so on the counter? I'm like, no, so-and-so is doing this, but we're busy. I understand, right? So they're getting pissed. They don't understand, right? They don't understand what I'm trying to do at this point. You know, I've explained to them, you know, like, I'm doing this, but they're just, you know, like, you know, they need help, and I get it, I understood, you know. So my guys are, you know, stressed out and irritated, right? But meanwhile, what's going on is now I have someone else, someone extra in the store doing some of the neglected stuff from the past, you know. And as time went by, I'd have them do more and more things. And I would hire more people and I would train them again for 4 hours a day for a week, every single day, dedicated, uninterrupted, right? And as time went by, I had all these people, all these new kids, right? Most of them were kids, they were young kids. And here's another thing, these were all young kids. So as far as they knew, I was boss. I was this adult and I wasn't really that old. I was only like maybe 25 years old or so, right? 24, 23 actually. But as far as they knew, I was the boss. I controlled their paycheck. I was their boss. They saw me with respect. They called me sir. And they didn't know that, you know, Steve used to get shit-faced drunk on the weekends and black out with the rest of the crew, right? They didn't have that bad perception of me. All they knew was what I presented at that moment. And that was professionalism, right? So I had to change too. I had to be more professional. But these guys were doing all my behind the scenes, you know, activities, all my behind the scenes, you know, compliance issues that had been neglected for so long. They started cleaning up my store. They started cleaning up my inventory. They started cleaning up my paperwork. They started cleaning up everything that was messed up. Still, they're not helping in the front room. Once the new guys were getting better versed at all their responsibilities, then I started, you know, pushing them onto the sales counter, onto the sales floor, and helping out up front. But at that point, they were ready for it. They were itching for it. One, because they were irritated, probably, you know, having to do all these boring tasks. But now, you know, now they're helping out on the front. And I had trained them, I had spent time with them on how to cashier and how to look up parts. So when they hit the floor running. They handled themselves. really good. And because they had understood all these other things from the back scenes, they understood a little bit more than some of my veterans. After just a short period of time, I had myself a pretty large crew of rookies, but these rookies were outshining my veterans. My veterans now were, you know, praising them and asking me, like, you know, where did you find so-and-so? You know, where did he work before? This dude worked at McDonald's, man. Really? Well, how about so-and-so? This is that guy's first job, you know? Like, they were impressed. Were they any different than the guys that I had fired during their 90-day probation? No, they weren't. They weren't. Everyone that I hired had potential. Everyone that I hired was a rough cut diamond. They were just a diamond without any fucking cuts or polishes. I never invested time to cut and polish my other guys, and that's why they didn't shine. My new guys, I polished them. I took time. While no one understood why I was in the back room for 4 hours a day, every single day, for like a month, basically, because I had hired person after person after person after person and spent all this time with each new employee, I was polishing them. I was cutting and polishing them. They were a fucking diamond. So when they hit the fucking sales floor, they fucking shined. They fucking sparkled like motherfuckers. And they were fucking good. And all they knew was what I told them, because I kept those people close to me. I kept them close. I let them know, if anybody else is being lazy and doesn't do their job, don't worry about them. I have a plan for them, okay? You do work. And if you don't have anything to do, you come to me and you ask me for more work, and I'll give you something to do. There's always something to do. You see how busy we are? We're always busy. Mind you, I'm fucking hustling, fucking 24/7 at work. I'm always fucking working, so I'm always moving back and forth, you know, hustling, you know, so I had a leg to stand on. I led with example. I fucking hustled, you know? So these guys saw that I worked hard, and I told them, like, I expect you to work at the same pace that I do, okay? I don't ask anybody to work less than me, you know? I don't ask anyone to work harder than I do. I work just as hard as everyone else, if not harder. So, you know, I need you to stay busy. These guys hustled day and night, and before I knew it, my veterans, who were once the majority, who once felt tough because they were, again, the majority, now were the minority. Now they were the few. I had more rookies than veterans, and I had more people doing their job than them not. So now I can go up to them and say, hey, I need this done. And now they don't want to be the only person that's not doing their job. Now they feel the pressure because they can't hide in the masses. The rookies are outshining them. The rookies are doing a better job. And they hated it. Now at that point, again, they either left on their own because they didn't want to work hard and they didn't respect me as their boss, or I got them out. But now I could get them out, because I had backup. I had my crew. I had a crew that I developed, my clones. And these clones were the ones that carried me to the top. They knew no different than what I told them. What I said was law, and that's it. They had no previous misconceptions of me or perceptions of me, of nothing. They just knew me as boss, yes sir, no sir, and they carried me to the top. Those guys, my old crew, like I said, they either got with it or they got out. The ones that stayed were because they respected what I had done, how I had changed, and they adapted, and they became good employees again. The ones that didn't, they left or I got rid of them. In the end, and this is now, mind you, this didn't all happen in a month. This took months and months and months of trial and error. But in the end, I had a crew that I could take to war with me. A crew that wouldn't back down and let me die on my own in the battlefield. I had my crew. And I went from being one of the worst ranked stores in the entire district to becoming the best ranked store in the entire district. And that's how I became district manager. That's why I got promoted. Not because only because my sales were great, but because my management and leadership skills had improved dramatically, because I proved that I could lead a crew, that I could transform and lead a crew to success, to record-breaking numbers. So, does that answer your question as far as, you know, how do you gain control of a crew? I don't know, but that's, again, how I did it. It was ugly, and it took a long time, and it took a lot of blood, sweat, and tears, but I did it. What you need, if your people don't understand, and they don't get with it, they don't want to get with the program, then you find people who will, and you keep them close to you. Do not let them develop bad habits with your bad apples. The bad apple spoils the bunch, right? Don't let them go to the dark side, right? Like water. Water travels in the path of least resistance. Well, your bad apples, they're gonna show you the shortcuts of how to do things, you know, the fast way, which is the sloppy way and the way that's not, you know, approved. They're gonna go that way. Don't let it. You need to keep your new people close to you. You need to train them and have everything that they learn, have it be from you. If you don't have time, you need to make time. You need to sacrifice either yours or everyone else's comfort for a future investment. Again, I spent a lot of time away from customers and from my employees, but what I was doing is I was investing time to develop a strong team, to teach them exactly what they needed to know to help me, to help my customers, and to help the crew. All right, guys, I hope that story, you know, identifies with some of you. I hope that story motivates some of you. If you guys have questions or you want to drop a comment, put it down below. Let me know what you think. And until next time, everybody, thank you for watching. See you next time. Peace.
Get down. Paid the cost to be the boss. Paid the cost to be the boss.